get in here for a while, so I have to, sorry, I have to get my own thing out of here.
While Matt is setting up, I forgot to mention that we still have tickets. If you like incredible Celtic Irish music, next week we have Seamus Egan, and who was the founder of Solas, an Irish group of some renown, who will be here with three or four other musicians of great stature as well. And there's still tickets available for the 4 p.m. show. The 7:30 show is sold out. But we added another show, so if you're interested, tell your friends or yourselves, go to the website and you know what to do if you're here. Oh, the other thing, I keep forgetting to mention this, you don't have to bring paper tickets here, you're on a list. So just tell us your name when you walk in, and you're either on the list or you stay outside.
Thank you.
Thing I've ever heard, and I thought being able to do it in Austria, in the music Verein and you know, Bruckner Hall, you know, I just thought this is like what a great opportunity. So I learned this crazy concerto by a composer called Lee Sang-yoon, a Korean composer, who's celebrating his 100-year anniversary of his birth this year. And he's got an incredible story, which I'll tell you in a second. But after learning this concerto, I literally went through withdrawal with this composer. I needed to play more music, and so I found a couple of solo cello pieces that he wrote, and that's what I'm going to play for you. I'm playing for the first time, actually, in public, this piece called Glissé Slides that he wrote. So the interesting thing about Lee Sang-yoon is, well, first of all, he's one of the first composers to bring Eastern, sort of Eastern influenced ideas and music and timbre and instruments to Western, to sort of the Schoenbergian atonal style, very hardcore. He lived in Darmstadt in Germany. He was in the 70s and 80s. You would never find a program in Germany without a piece of Lee Sang-yoon. He was a big deal in Germany, but he never quite came over to North America. And in the 60s, he was the South Korean government, he's South Korean, but the South Korean government abducted him, kidnapped him from Germany, imprisoned him, and tortured him for 3 or 4 years in South Korea. He was accused of espionage against them, sort of pro-North Korea. All he was doing, he was all for just the reunification of North and South Korea, and he would just go back and forth between the sides and just making music. And now, in fact, there's a theater in North Korea named after him. So anyway, he has this incredible story, and finally, I think Leonard Bernstein and a bunch of musicians, a bunch of artists and major figures worked hard to get him released, and finally he was released. And one of the first pieces that he wrote was that cello concerto, and he was himself was a cellist, so it's really kind of remarkable writing for the instrument. So this piece that I'm going to play for you was written in 1970, and in a way it's like a cello concerto, but without the big orchestra part. But you'll hear me also use the plectrum in the third movement, so it's kind of like a well, it's a guitar thing, but really plays like some of the Korean or Chinese ancient instruments. And so, yeah, it's in four movements, and hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
project that's ocean themed, kind of an environmental project that we're going to do in Washington, D.C. in October. And we wanted to play for you a piece that we worked out in Burlington, Vermont a week ago, which was actually kind of a take on Vivaldi, a double concerto, Il Doppio Il Mondo, the world is upside down. And in fact, Vivaldi, well, we're not going to play it, so I shouldn't go too far into it. But, we wanted to play that for you, but it requires electronics, and we had all kinds of technology issues, and so we can't do it today. So what we do have for you is actually a duo by a local composer, Luna Pearl Wolf, who I'm her husband. And Luna's here today, but I'll tell you a little bit about the piece. This is a duo. She's gotten very busy lately, and so she's ripping herself off, basically. She wrote a piece for it as a trio with violin, cello, and percussion. And it's kind of a theater instrumental piece called Mélange à Toi. Oh. Not Mélange. But it's a great story, actually. But anyway, we needed a duo last summer or two summers ago, and so the writing was so great for the violoncello, I actually asked if we could turn it into a duo, and that's what she's done. She's taken the violoncello material and kind of created a duo piece out of this trio. So it becomes a more traditional relationship, in a way. the original was very, let's see, the great story if I can remember it. So the percussion player was, in the original cast, is female, cellist is male. It was actually a student of mine who played the premiere, Juan Delgado. And they are in a relationship. And it starts off with solo cello. The percussion player has her arms around the cello and is sort of caressing the cello, a very sensual kind of opening. Clearly, they're in a relationship, these two. Enter the suave violinist, another male, and catches the attention of the percussionist, charms her, and they have, there's a wonderful scene in the mélange with kind of a dinner scene, actually, with wine, lots of wine glasses, and there's this kind of a chorale going on with the wine glasses and the string players, and something happens in that there's a certain chemistry between the percussionist, the woman, and the violinist. Meanwhile, the cellist is getting really very jealous and very pissed off and very upset about the whole thing, and challenges the violinist to a duel. And so bows are flying, they're duking it out, and something happens in the middle of this fight where the two guys realize, actually, they kind of like each other. And they kind of end up together. And so the original music that you hear at the beginning kind of comes back in this two-guy music. And then, meanwhile, the percussionist is like, just about to commit suicide on the ground. She's lost everything. Anyway, that's how that happens. So now we've reduced all of that to two players, but you can sort of follow the story. The story is still fairly intact here. We don't have wine glasses. Instead, we create a chorale in double stops and tremolos between us, but that's the story. So please welcome Lina Bahn. I was asked to say a word about the notation in the Izang-yun piece. I'm not sure where to begin, except to say that it's absolutely meticulously fully notated. I mean, everything you had, you know, I might have made a few things up, but not intentionally. He's not only concerned, I mean, his sense of pitch is very exacting and very thoughtful and linear. But he's also he introduces microtones, so he does notate those with, he has his own system. When he wants it sharp, he puts a hat over the note, and when he wants it slightly flatter, he puts a U over it, so you know what degree to go up or down. He's very interested in timbre, so everything is notated in terms of timbre, but he's using timbres that we don't normally use in Western music. So he's using colenio, the stick part of the bow. He's using, of course, the plectrum that I use, for the pizzicato, that creates a whole different texture of sound. He's also notates whether he wants me to press the string all the way down or not with the left hand. And when I don't, I can show you the difference. I mean, if I press the note all the way down, I get a pitch. And if I don't, I get that. Well, I don't have the A string. So he's notating that kind of a sound, this kind of almost aleatoric sort of, a different pitch. It reminds me of, now I can go on forever. One of my favorite experiences was playing at a club in New York City called Poisson Rouge. It's still going on, I basically was trying to show that I didn't like the idea of playing a piano. I thought piano and cello don't belong together, and so I wanted to show how unusual and terrible the cello-piano combination was, so I decided to bring a DJ with me in addition to a pianist. So I had a DJ cello piece called Vinyl Cello, and then I had the cello-piano piece by Elliot Carter. And I thought I was doing something interesting that night, but a young student came back to me backstage and she said, do you ever do anything really avant-garde? I didn't know what to tell her, and so what do you mean? I thought, am I bringing a DJ, cello, we're at a club, and she said, pitch is so overrated. But I think with Izang-yun, he's really, pitch is, he's very, very interested in pitch, but he's also interested in all these other, in timbre and in time. They're in, not the concerto, because there's an orchestra, I think, he notates, with time signatures. They're complex, but he uses them. In the solo piece, there is no bar line through the whole piece. But very much, very exact temporal indications of how things should last, and that's about. There's a whole at the end of the or the beginning of the piece, he gives you a kind of like a map of all the different effects and how to achieve them, and the problem for me is. Well, thankfully, he doesn't write in Korean. He writes in German. But that's just as hard for me to try to understand exactly what he intends. But anyway, there's a lot of German writing. Normally, things are written actually in Italian for us, but in German also. But he's very much a German kind of style composer in the kind of second babies school. So that's that. And now here's a piece that I picked up from Philip Glass. As I was recording the two partitas, I asked the producer, we had a little time left in the session, and I asked the producer, there's got to be something else, solo cello, that I can play at Phillips. And he thought about it, he said, yeah, actually, Philip has this collaboration with Leonard Cohen, the singer-songwriter, and there was a cello solo from that collaboration, and let me get it out. He printed it out. And this producer, Michael Riesemann, he's sort of Philip Glass's right-hand man for everything. He directs, he copies, he arranges, he does everything for Philip. And we went through 3 days, and he was very exacting on me, you know, just, you know, play in tune, play in time, play in whatever. Like, he was just very, very strict about everything. And then he gave me this piece, and I sight read it in the recording session. And basically, that was a tape for recording. Yeah, that's the only time I've ever seen him impressed. I'm really impressed with my sight reading. So, I'm no longer sight reading, I hope, but this is, it's called Paris Sky. And I thought that would be a nice segue into the Ravel joke. And it's on the Philip Glass CD. Did I mention that?
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.